So I'm Sam. I'm talking about Swift as a first programming language. Paris gave me this slide. I prefer mine. So yeah, I love Taylor Swift. She's amazing. I think we all do. So yeah, who the hell am I? So I'm Sam. I work at Carnival. Carnival is a mobile marketing automation startup based in Wellington and New York. So Wellington's in New Zealand, why I sound funny. I'm a recent graduate from University of Canterbury in Christchurch in New Zealand. Did a Bachelor of Science there with honours. And while I was there, I studied under Dr. Tim Bell. So I've done a lot of work with the CS Unplugged project, which is a set of classroom activities and kind of outdoor activities, you know, sports field, playground activities to teach computer science about a computer. So there's a talk earlier about state machines. We do that with cones and balls and stuff like that. So it's really exciting. I'm also a contributor to the Computer Science Field Guide, which is an online textbook helping computer science in high schools. So I've been doing apps since I was 17. I had 12 or so apps before I left high school on the store. I just did freelancing throughout university, ventured over into .NET land for 2 years, but we don't talk about that. And yeah, I'm back on the lead iOS developer at Carnival. So today, talk about three things. So what's sort of the state of coding, the state of learning to code, what's happened, what they did, why they did that, where we're going, and then I'll move on to Swift as a contender for a first programming language, and then I'll put it through its paces in terms of, you know, is it actually a viable introductory programming language. So part one, the state of learning to code. So it's the late 2000s. We've just had the dot-com bubble burst. A lot of people lost a lot of money, mum and dad investors, not like now when it's just Facebook founders losing their money, no one cares. Enrollments in computer science is under drop heaps, but the demand for talent's still sort of there, so we're getting some shortages. And the worst thing that happened this time was schools saw this, and like high schools, tertiaries, and they said, we'll go back to teaching how to use Word, scrap the electronic stuff, scrap the computer science, scrap the programming. And yeah, we'll start with these practical skills like Word and Publisher. Remember Publisher? Classic. So moving forward to the early 2010s, the industry has had enough of the shortage. Like nothing was being done about it. You know, we're getting no one prepared out of. No one was going into university. No one's coming out of high school with an interest in computer science or programming. Just terrible. So in New Zealand and around the world, there was heaps of pressure put on the government by our sort of Institute of IT Professionals, our national body, to start doing something about it. So there were reports written, people, lots of lobbying. So in 2011, we had these new subjects. So the old subjects for high schools were, yeah, how to use Word and things like that, and they were classed as, you know, bum subjects. You know, people who had lesser academic ability would do these subjects. And it just wasn't taken seriously. Like, you'd go there, you'd mess around in class, and you'd get your pass or fail, and you'd leave again. So in 2011, we got digital tech. So digital technologies is a group of topics, and these are the topics. And you know, these are achieved merit excellence. These are things you can pass and to a higher degree in the New Zealand school system. And then the teachers panicked. So we had 2011. They only had a year to see this coming, and that's hardly enough time to upskill. These are, you know, your typing teachers, your math teachers, average age 55, typically women, completely out of touch. Not their fault. They're just, it's new. Understandably, they had like no confidence. A year to upskill is just nothing. Like, it takes some years to get your head around a curriculum and, you know, to understand something enough to know well enough to teach it again. They were just not feeling 100%. And even if they had more time, they didn't actually have any resources to do this with. So there was no textbooks, there were no, you know, hundreds of books written on maths or physics. There's nothing out there for programming at the time. So ideally, yeah, not great. Eventually, we got heaps more resources. So we had some of the common languages come through, Scratch, Python, Java, JavaScript. It's cool. For online coding, we had Code Academy and Code Avengers. For like in-person clubs, we had Code.org, which had their Hour of Code, so people get together, learn how to code for an hour. It's very fun. Last year was based on Frozen, like the movie. So you had Elsa skating around, pretty much doing turtle graphics. It's pretty cool. And we have code clubs like, you know, Code Club World and Code Club Aotearoa and Code Club Australia. We also had the CS Field Guide and CS Unplugged, which have, you know, been around for a while, but the CS Field Guide has suddenly came to its own in the last few years. We're starting to get a bit of an awareness for this. The industry was sort of starting to get aware, and the parents and the public starting to get aware that, this is happening in schools. You know, people are learning to code, and it's all over the news, and it's awesome. There's an increase in coding worldwide. You know, we're talking South America, the USA, South Korea, UK, Israel even, Russia, Australia, New Zealand, and it's just spreading out. And yeah, things keep ticking along. It's great. Part two, the reveal. So it's June 2014. This guy gets up on stage, Air Force One, and we get this, Swift. I've said here the old Star Wars line. And we got Swift Playgrounds, which are really cool. And no doubt this is a Brett Victor-inspired thing. He does cool stuff, and he was at Apple for a while. And this year we got Playground Pages, which is certainly very, very cool. And the thing is that Playgrounds seek to innovate the way we teach coding. And it's why we're considering Swift as a programming language. So when I say Swift is the first programming language, I don't mean making apps. I mean using a playground, because it makes sense. And so today I'll be talking about why I would want to use this and why you might not want to. So playgrounds look amazing. Look at this. Like, that's cool. Playgrounds have all these great things. REPL, live, all this sort of stuff. Markdown support, rewind, fast forward, quick look on variables and stuff like that. Swift seems amazing. People are loving it. And I love this meme. SwiftLang, so hot right now. So let's use Swift. Yeah. But stop. Really. Is Swift actually any good for learning to code? So you gotta ask yourself. What makes a first good programming language? This is something we've got to ask ourselves. Does it even matter? Like, why should we even care? And we care because of this. Your first programming language can open or close your mind forever. So what I mean by that is, you know, it's your first impression with coding. You know, we teach coding, we encourage coding for everyone to give it a go. We don't mind if they actually like it or not, we just want them to find out. Because often people like it, and they didn't think they would. So what are the common factors we hear about, why you should learn a particular language? So the most obvious one, the most common one is, oh, we use this at work. So you have your friend Bill, who works at Boringcom, who's like 55, 60, says, oh, we use Java Enterprise Edition, 1.2. So he shows the teacher of it, and then you end up in classes like this, where we all read down the board all together now. Public, static, void, main, which is just a freaking nightmare. Like, the sheer amount of concepts you need to know to understand what each of those words mean. And then you go into like abstract factories. And then there's this, like, clips, God. Ugh. The other one you hear is like, oh, you should use this, so then you can do that. So like, you should use Java because you can make Android apps, or JavaScript because you can make websites, or Python because you can do Django, and like Objective-C because you can do iOS apps, and like Rails, like Ruby because you can do Rails and make apps. It's really cool. And the students just there going, ah. Like, it's just overwhelming. It's scary. It's confusing as heck. Like, as soon as you say you can do something to a student, they have to do that. They're a failure if they don't. And then like imposter syndrome kicks in, and like lesser able students just drop out, and they start talking to each other, and they just start hating it. Oh, it's just a mess. So we try to avoid that. So what are the actual factors? And there's been a fair amount of academic research that's gone into what makes a good introductory language. And the framework I've chosen is kind of clear, and it both factors for and kind of rules out that sort of industry pressure, which is nice. So, Linda Miller and Michael G. Rutt wrote this structure, and it's kind of in four groups. So we have learning, design of environment, support and availability, and what happens beyond introductory programming. I'll be comparing it to the now standard, which is Python, which is an OO language. There's some contention at the moment about, is OO or procedural languages a good way to teach programming versus, functional. for the sake of the talk, I'll assume yes. And it seems to be working well in schools, so I think that's what I'm going with. So learning. So the first thing we think about learning is that the code must be as understandable as plain English. So not really, but simple syntax, natural semantics, no cryptic symbols like in, you know, like R or APL, no weird abbreviations like, I think it was, another language I saw once was like, to get the first object out of an array, it wasn't like zero, it was FRST, there's like some cryptic abbreviation, it was weird. So just none of these sort of sources of confusion which can really throw people off. So it should really read like pseudocode. Like, when we're teaching programming, we usually use pseudocode first, so if something can go from pseudocode, like if something in list or for, you know, letter in Word, if it translates to that, it sort of sounds quite nice, and it makes sense. So the important thing here to remember is that a good teaching language should promote learning the concepts and not the syntax. So let's look at our first Python versus Swift example. So it's Swift at the top and Python, they look pretty similar. So now, full letter in Word, print letter, if something equals true, do something similar in Python. They have indentation versus brackets for scope and blocks. And so you can sort of see that Swift's really benefited from ditching the Objective-C kind of small talky syntax. It's like Objective-C without the C, and it's just a brilliant idea. So it's a lot easier to read, a lot easier to write, and less scary than object message send. The next thing is the language should cross into the physical world. So what I mean by this is that people should be able to, people like love to see physical examples like lights, sounds, basically multimedia capabilities in your language, even just something in the output or like a nice GUI. Because fundamentally, people learn better with physicality. And like we've all done turtle graphics where you move a turtle around the screen, it will draw behind itself when you put the pen up or down. Logo was a very famous learning language for that, which was pretty much deprecated by Python. And, you know, it's a popular way to teach control statements, you know, loops and conditionals. You know, here's a turtle moving around the screen. So in terms of multimedia capabilities, Swift and Python nail it. Swift especially on the iPhone, like making things vibrate, that's what haptic feedback is pretty cool. Python has the added benefit of kind of running sort of everywhere at the moment, sort of all platforms. The next thing is the language should offer a good framework. It's important that the language is sort of feature complete. There's no weird sort of process to get other bits of the language in. So there's no weird linking or compiling to get other sort of fundamental things in. So yeah, all the fundamentals of coding have got to be there, and this is once again in terms of procedural stuff. So variables, conditions, loops, functions. In New Zealand, these are sort of the fundamentals we cover in high school, your second to last year. In your last year, you move on to things like classes and GUIs, but this is what we start with. We start with variables, move on to conditions, loops, and functions. And whilst they might be bread and butter for us, they're actually quite tricky for some students to get their head around. And it's a good time to know whether or not they're capable of it or not. So comparing the two, Swift has all the things, Python has all the things, and its OO is kind of a bit more basic, but you know, we're not teaching that much OO stuff, so it's not too bad. Just once again, there's still a debate raging about whether or not we should be teaching OO first or functional first. I'm on the side of OO, just because when I write functional code and I tilt my head slightly, the brain sort of oozes out, like the sort of liquid stuff. It's kind of gross. Next thing is the language should promote a good approach for learning and writing software. So for beginners, we're not only just teaching coding, we're teaching, you know, teamwork and design and tests and, you know, architecture and how to use a library and, you know, your language should promote these. So it should, you know, culminate in a nice design when you use all these things. So comparing Swift and Python again, like we have nice standard libraries on both. Bringing in Cocoa Touch on Swift is certainly nicer. The languages are both nice. And Playgrounds are pretty cool. Playgrounds allow you to kind of ignore your design and just focus on inputs and outputs, how many times things get run, order of statements, repeating statements, sort of these fundamentals of coding, if you will. So just a recap on learning. Both looking pretty good. So, yeah. Moving on to design and environment. So interaction and fast pace, we gotta love it. So basically the language should allow you to write stuff, write things fast. Fail fast, fail often, you know, all that sort of jazz. They want to be able, like students, like they just want to start. Just let them start. Don't say, oh, you want to write Java? Cool, let's talk about installing Eclipse. Which version do you need? Do you need the enterprise version or do you need the basic version? Oh, you want to use Visual Studio? Cool, which 8 of the 10 versions do you want to install? Just none of that, it's gross. Like playgrounds, like open up the file, click like write print line, hit save, it'll just work. Playgrounds allow this, allow very interactive and rapid code development. Students won't get bored and students will stay motivated, which is really cool. Like, there's nothing worse than opening up a new Xcode project for a student and saying, let's make an iPhone app, and they go, cool, what's an app delegate? And you're like, well, delegation is this, blah, blah, blah. And just eyes glaze over and you're like, oh, lost them. So, yeah. Switch from Python to Hello World very nicely. That's it. You know, open this, open the file, type this, hit save, you'll be fine. Immediate feedback on whether or not the student's doing it right. Output's great. You probably think at this point, like, what about IPython, IPython notebooks? I've tried them, they're crap. No. The next thing is the language promotes writing of correct programs. So by equipping students with a language that promotes correctness, we prepare them to become a successful professional developer who's able to deliver a bug-free system. Fingers crossed. So, you know, a language should kind of promote a way that bugs get caught before it runs. So things like design by contract and strongly typed and testable. And good languages, in an academic opinion, are ones that try not to err out at runtime. So Swift is super nice for things like optionals and guard and iflets and whatnot. If you use them, you don't just go exclamation mark everywhere because you think you know better. But Python doesn't really come to the table on that one. Python is like dynamic typed, so you can get like really nasty runtime errors when you try to, you think something's an integer and you turn it to a string and you get a very cryptic error, which for a beginner programmer is hard to read. Hard to interpret, hard to find out what you're doing wrong. Whereas Swift, you'll get like an inline compile time error and it'll go red and it'll say fix this, and you click fix this and it'll teach you how to fix it, which is pretty cool. Lastly on this, both Swift and Python uses type inference for basic types. So you can actually just figure out what type it is based on the literal, which if you're a novice programmer, you're using literals a lot. So string literals, you know, like hello or, you know, your name or a number, anything like that. So that comes in handy later when you can really just avoid that part of the syntax. You can avoid that kind of colon type and sort of bring it in later as the types become more complex and harder to kind of guess. The next thing is the language allows problems to be solved in chunks. So doing things one bit at a time is super important for education. You know, imagine you've got like a 50-minute class and you want to get something done during that class. It makes sense to do it. You don't want to have to be fleshing out 20 or 30, you know, classes in Java to figure out, you know, just to print something. Has anyone seen that? I think it was FizzBuzz Enterprise Edition. It's like 200 classes to do the FizzBuzz puzzle. It's pretty nuts. So the cool thing about modularization is it's in Swift and allows you to work on things together, allows you to view things from the top and deep dive in, or fix something here and, you know, make sure other parts rely on it, it's fine. So you can fix small bits while understanding the big picture. It's great. So Swift has all the things, functions, classes, inheritance, composition. Python has functions and classes and some basic inheritance. Not really important for a novice, but certainly that our mindset in the language may have some positive advantages later on, but it's kind of yet to be seen. This is a big one. So the language provides a seamless development environment. So half the impression someone gets from coding is what program they have to open to start coding in. So that's why I wouldn't suggest Emacs or Vim as a novice IDE. I'd suggest something like Xcode or Wing for Python. It's pretty cool. So the thing to remember about IDEs is that a great IDE helps, not hides. So, you know, I've been in Microsoft land for a couple of years, and while, you know, Visual Studio is amazing for professional developers who just need to get things done, it does hide quite a bit. And if something breaks, you've got this black box to try poke and prod, and it sort of becomes more of a hindrance than a help. And an IDE should sort of be one that you can transition into the real world with as well. So not like a toy IDE or just, you know, a simple text editor that you might not use in the real world. So yeah, playgrounds are a fantastic IDE. We talk about autocomplete, you know, obviously constant REPL, all that sort of stuff I mentioned before. Wing, or IDLE, which is like the flagship IDE for Python, that sort of comes on your system. A little bit terrible. It's basically a glorified text editor with a run button. So yeah, basically, in recap, Swift blows Python out of the world, water for IDE reasons. But in terms of the other things, they're pretty on par. So the reason that Swift has got a better IDE is just there's a large company behind it. Xcode's pretty good. Visual Studio's pretty good. Dare I say, Eclipse is pretty good. But nothing, no one company is kind of behind, you know, Python in terms of making an IDE. So, yeah, for free, I should say. PyCharm's pretty cool. Support and availability. So, the language has a supportive user community. So it's really important that a tool set, like, you know, a language, sort of sticks around, because otherwise, you know, someone will learn it and it will go obsolete. Sort of lack of resources or anything like that will be quite restrictive for programmers, novice programmers or teachers. So I guess, does Swift have a nice community? Yep, we do. Like, you're all here, hello. And there's only more. But at the moment, I think Python's just edging out our community a little bit. I've written here for now, as more of us sort of accept the fact we're going to have to start learning Swift and move to Swift from Objective-C, there'll be more. And there'll be more of us thinking about, this bit was actually confusing. I wonder how I'd explain that to an 8-year-old. So it's pretty cool. The next criteria is the language is open source, so anyone can contribute to its development. So unless the language is kind of backed fully by a company like C#'s, that's by Microsoft, open source is kind of the only way it sort of pushes forward. It also means the skills are portable to other platforms like Python. So I guess the question is, will we see an open source Swift? I've heard later this year, but frankly, I'll believe it when I see it, thanks. Until that day it goes up on GitHub, I don't consider Swift open source. It's, you know, it's just might not happen. It's, we'll let Apple try. So, Python, better than Swift for this reason. Python's open source, runs on all platforms. It's IDEs and stuff run on all platforms as well. It has web implementations like Code Academy. And Apple kind of just needs to hurry up and open source it. So, you know, educators can start working with it. Following on from open source, another criteria is the language is consistently supported across platforms. So, you know, once again, this is an argument for open source. Let's get onto it, Apple. But yeah, good teaching languages should be available on any platform. First-class support is a key, not just some hacky kind of port or some nasty LLV hack. I mean, like a first-class citizen on that operating system. So Swift is on Mac OS X, and Python's, you know, everywhere. And you might think, oh, well, we've all got a Mac, but if you consider people less than ourselves, lower socioeconomic areas, rural schools, getting a Mac, like a $2,000, $3,000 laptop is probably not feasible, and then times that by 20 for a classroom set, it's looking harder than just a web browser at this point. But once it's open source, it'll only be a matter of time before we do it on the web, and there are a few things on the web starting to appear by people doing some nifty stuff with server-side Swift processing. So the language should be freely and easily available. So what I mean by this is, you know, not only open source, but also not behind any paywalls, not behind a big screed of documentation or any sort of weird thing, not silly to set up like Visual Studio is, and it should be available worldwide to all countries, not behind the Great Firewall of China or anything like that, just freely available. So Swift is freely available, but it's a bit of a big download. Like, the last beta was close to 8 gigabytes, which is cool. Like, you know, if you're living in Central City and you've got the fiber, that's cool. But if you're out in the WOPS, like in the middle of the outback, or, you know, rural New Zealand, or even, you know, suburban New Zealand, 8 gigs is a big ask. So it's a little bit exclusionary. But yeah, the open source effort will once again fix this. Hopefully, eventually. Python, it's basically installed in your system, so that's pretty cool. It's pretty accessible, and if you don't have it, you can install it with a package file, and it's pretty trivial to get set up. And if you don't want to do that, just go online. This is a pretty obvious one. Language is supporting with good teaching material. The more teaching material, the better. Basically, we need a lot more Swift teaching resources for this to work. Apple has a book. It's for us. It's for people who know Objective-C, who know iOS, and just want to transition over. That's true enough. It was a big use case. But it doesn't really help novice programmers. It's not a learn how to do Swift from nothing Swift stage. So they tried this. This is Apple's Swift education page. It's on GitHub. It looks pretty cool. You can do iOS apps in Swift. It takes you through a whole course. It's sort of written for K-12 educators, high school educators. But if you look close at the thing, it actually says, look, we actually want you to have prior programming experience. This is not a novice course. This is, you know how to do some coding. Let's make apps. So that's all right. I've started one. This is called NCA Swift. So NCA is the high school curriculum name in New Zealand. It's up on my GitHub. I started writing it. Pending motivation, it'll get finished. One thing I did notice with Swift is that a very common pattern we see in beginner languages is let's make a greeter program where you type in your name, we'll say hello. So you'll type in, raw input, get the raw input, put it in a string with string interpolation saying, hello, Sam. So I'll type in Sam, we'll say hello, Sam, or good morning, Sam. Swift doesn't have anything like that yet, which is kind of annoying. And that's why I kind of halted on the book and sort of thought about this stronger. So a raw input in Swift would be very nice. Just some way to get standard in. Thing to remember about learning is that learning is bespoke. One size does not fit all. I could write a book, but that's one resource. It has one set of analogies, one set of examples, one set of, way of thinking about it. But students, especially with coding, need more examples, more ways of thinking about it, more ways of coming at the problem, just so they can click with those concepts. So it's really important that we get just duplicate resources, really. Slightly different examples. From different backgrounds, different cultures, anything like that, all helps with getting hand around reasonably complicated concepts like programming concepts. So, So open source is sort of hindering Swift in the support and availability section. Python's there, it's a bit older, so it's winning. But Swift is staying, here to stay. And things are growing. The teaching resources are growing day by day. I just heard this morning that Ray Mendelich is putting out a book about, just Swift, not apps, Swift. So that's pretty exciting. I'll have to have a look at that. So the last section is beyond introductory programming. What can you do once you've got the language and once you've left high school or university? So one of the key things we look at is with educational languages that they should be used not only in education. So, we've seen these toy languages, Blockly, Scratch, they're cool. We use some kids, we use Scratch Junior on the iPad, but no one's writing enterprise software in Scratch. I'd love to see them though. So the idea is that it translates into professional code, professional language, or is just used in the industry. So for Swift, you can do iOS and Mac apps. Python, you can kind of do anything. I'll keep in mind that Python, half of Google runs on Python, and bits of Go. But who knows where we'll see this when it's open source? We don't know if the language everywhere will be Go. We don't know if it'll be Rust. Or we don't know if it'll be Swift. Someone could take Swift, make a Rails equivalent with it, but then they can make a JavaScript equivalent with it. It could be anything. So I'm pretty excited about the open sourcing stuff if it happens. The language is extensible, and that's to say it has modules. So modules are cool, but what's actually great about them? Students should be able to experiment with many domains. So they should be able to start simple and readily access more. So say if they want to start on basic programming and then start doing some statistics stuff, they might be in Python, they might import NumPy and figure out what's going on there and do some stat stuff, draw a graph, find out some means and averages and that sort of stuff. So Swift, we have these import statements, the same with Python. And we've also got nice dependency managers like CocoaPods and Carthage, and Python has pip. So you can pip install NumPy, you can pod install DodeKit, and it'll just work. So that's pretty neat. It means you can learn the basics and then start exploring areas you're interested in and teach students about the concept of We're not programming as an industry. We're in other industries, and it's just a context. So the language itself has to be actually pretty good. So there's this old school mentality that real languages have to compile. And we've all seen the XKCD of the two guys in the seats fighting with swords and saying, yeah, just compiling. But anything shiny or new can't be trusted. It's just nonsense. Time and time again, just-in-time compiled languages have proven themselves suitable for education. Python is just-in-time compiled. JavaScript and Swift all just run very fast. There's no big, long build time like there is in Java or C#. And it's, once again, coming down to this impression of coding. Is coding typing something, waiting 20 minutes and seeing if you're right or wrong? No, it's typing something and knowing, almost by the end of your last keystroke whether or not you're right or wrong. It makes a big impact. So Swift is awesome. Python's pretty awesome, just based on the idea that you run them. But they're both in the race. It's pretty cool. And they're both great for education reasons. And they're still better than, Java compile, Java jar, Java run, which is just gross. The language is not a hack. So sometimes you see languages which are a hack. They're just a first effort thing, and that's fine. But educational languages should be a well thought out thing. Has anyone heard of the QWERTY phenomena? So QWERTY keyboards are designed the way they are because based on the hammers that came down on typewriters, least commonly pressed keys together had to be moved apart, which is a weird thing that we still have them on modern keyboards. But people are starting to realize that Dvorak is actually a better keyboard in terms of getting text out of your head into the computer. So things like that, you have to worry about the language. Is it a first stab? That sort of stuff. The thing that is good here is that Swift is in it for the long run. Swift was designed to replace Objective-C. It was Apple's big middle finger to Objective-C in its next step days. They are fully gone, Unfortunately, Steve is gone, Scott Forstall is gone, and now Objective-C is gone. So for a platform for software, it's not going anywhere anytime soon. We might not be writing Swift apps in 50 years' time, but, for the next 20 or 30 years, Swift is going to be here. Importantly, Swift isn't a fad. We've all seen fads. Great examples of fads are JavaScript frameworks. I've had bottles of milk last longer than a JavaScript framework. So it's great. So in summary there, Swift, here for the long run, great. Python, also not going anywhere. And people are even having trouble moving to Python 3, which is quite funny. So to recap, beyond introductory programming, once it's open sourced, we're starting to see a lot of good stuff for this. And Apple's courses are pretty good, and more resources will pile up. It'll be great. So I guess the big question is, does Swift have a place in the classroom? Soon. What I'd like to see is some more stability to the language. Last night I received a book on programming in Swift, and it's out of date. So that's fun. I'd like to see it open sourced, which would help with the rest of the stuff. And it kind of follows through. So you should try it. You should take your children or your siblings and see how far they get. Give it a try. See how you go. Let me know how you get on. Why are we doing this? Well, you're probably all hiring at the moment. You're probably all finding it's a bit hard to find people. So obviously, pipeline thing. If we teach coding with Swift, we'll end the shortage of great iOS developers, which will be pretty cool. And largely, we all win. So clearly education's a win. Hopefully today I've shown that Swift is capable of being taught as a programming language, which is pretty cool in schools. We've got a long way to go before it gets into schools, and but it could come out to beat Python, but just because of the playground stuff. There are some practicalities that get in the way of this. Should we replace Python with Swift? Well, yes and no. So a lot of teachers are still upskilling, which is cool. So a lot of teachers are asking me, I actually want to teach Swift or Go in the classroom. Are they good? And this is sort of what this talk is here to answer. But for teachers who are already cooking with gas with Python, to stop them, make them retrain in Swift, probably not the best idea. It's not really going to matter. It doesn't really matter if you learn Swift first, as long as they gave it a go. We just want to see kids, adults, and novices just giving it a go. So I want to finish off with a quote from our beloved. Everyone should learn how to code because it teaches you how to think. I've been Sam. I'm the iOS guy at carnival.io. check us out, follow me on Twitter. Thanks for listening.